Now, she's a team elite and part of the $20 million Circle Club with Nu Skin and an NTC Chief Ambassador and also a Female Entrepreneur of the Year of USA. So, I have a little saying from her. Lead by example and take the actions you'd like to see your entire organization duplicate every day. So, listen up. It's the Laura Call in person from USA. Take it away, Laura.
Take it away.
American woman, stay away from me. American woman, mama, let me be. Don't come hanging around my door. I don't wanna see your face no more. I got more important things to do. Spend my time going on with you. Now, woman, stay away. American woman.
I think I like that other song even better. That kind of really got the energy flowing. So I am so excited to be here in Barcelona. How many people here are from Spain? I want to see my homeland hosts. Right, woohoo! I have to tell you real quickly that when I was in college, I had the opportunity to come and spend a semester here in Spain and fell in love with this country and, of course, with Europe in general, which is why many of you know Europe is mine and my husband's passion, and we come here every summer. Absolutely love it. And we were able to give the gift to our daughter, Jessica, to come to Spain last summer and spend the summer kind of traveling around, studying. And she spent her final week here in Barcelona and absolutely loves it. So I actually just want everyone to welcome my daughter, Jessica, who I'm going to make stand. So excited to have her here, and I just need her to see how many young people are doing this business. So how many people are in this room in your 20s or 90s or teens? Let me hear you. Okay. That is awesome. That is so cool. Love it. Yeah. Where else, right? So I started in this business in my 20s. I was 22. I was right out of graduating from college. And it's really funny because when you're young, it's not always so clear what your why is. I knew what my why was right from day one. I knew I wanted to have a family and get married at a young enough age and have children. And more than anything, I wanted to be able to have a business that would allow me to do both, to be able to enjoy quality of family and at the same time be able to have a business where I could be an independent businesswoman. How many independent businesswomen am I speaking to here today? I want to hear you. Excellent. I knew I wanted to be married, but I knew I also wanted to be in control of my own financial destiny. Never wanted someone to tell me that I could or could not buy those pair of Jimmy Choo's. So I always, I'm hoping my daughter's paying attention to this. So in any case, I always knew that this was the right business vehicle. I will say that I cheated a little in that I grew up in a home where my parents were a Nu Skin. And I will tell you that I got to see their lifestyle change dramatically before my own eyes. So what happened was my parents, my dad was in traditional business and he worked hard and he made a nice living, but as soon as he stopped working, his income stopped. And then he got introduced to Nu Skin. And I got to see their lifestyle change completely before my own eyes. It wasn't just about the money, although the money was pretty exciting. It was about the lifestyle. It was about being able to do what you want to do when you want to do it. And I was able to see this incredible journey where they went from what I would consider to be fairly stressed out business success to an incredible lifestyle where they could work hard, and then when they decided or needed to stop working for different issues in the family, that the money didn't stop. And I will tell you, with my own family, that's been my gift. I worked really hard in my 20s so that when I reached the 30s and I started having children, that I was able to be home with the kids and make my children my priority and build my business around that. And I will tell you, I can't even begin to explain how many of my friends gave up successful careers and businesses to be home with their kids, and then their income stopped. And many of them who have chosen to go back to work found it wasn't so easy to re-enter into the workforce 10 or 15 years later. With Nu Skin, we have the ability to pick it up and press down hard on that gas pedal whenever we want. And if we need to kind of lighten it up, maybe because there's something different going on in our lives, we're able to do that. And it's such a gift, so I just like to always start out thanking Nu Skin. So, awesome. Thank you. So I want to jump into my talk because I know we don't really have all that much time, and I could stand up here for hours filling your head with stories. I want to gently just kind of introduce you as to how I got started in the business. You know, I started with this incredible belief system, which is where the part where I said I cheated. I immediately knew that this was the right company, right products, right time, right? I totally got that. And I knew that this is one of these businesses where in a relatively short period of time, you can completely change your life. So that was my advantage. Unbelievable belief level, company, industry. But my disadvantage was that I didn't really have a great circle of influence. And one of the first things my dad said to me was, you know, you've just graduated from college, and all of your friends are going on to law school and med school, and they're not really the right time in their life for a business. Who are you going to talk to? And I said, I don't know. Somehow, some way, I'll figure it out. And honestly, at 22, I don't even understand if I knew what that meant. But thankfully, I was kind of a little, you know, naive at the moment. And I just, and because there was really no one at that time going out, walking and talking and building a business that way. It was a little bit more traditional. But in my head, I knew, because I grew up with this belief system, that if you want something badly enough, you make it happen. No excuses. So the fact that I didn't have a list, there was no reason to have an excuse. I just had to go out there and meet new people. So I'm going to just kind of start off a little traditionally. We all know friends, family, business, community, right? Everyone starts out, no matter what, you create that list and you start to think about your list is your inventory. If you owned a clothing store, your inventory would be what? Clothes, right, clothes, store, whatever it is that you're selling. And if you walked into your store and there were one or two items, how well do you think you would do? Not very. So your inventory are people. So that list has to be pretty robust. You don't want to edit your list because you will find that if you edit your list by thinking, oh, he's too rich or she's too successful or they're too busy, you're going to wind up finding them in somebody else's business. How many people in this room has that ever happened to? You ignored someone on your warm market only to find them. And how did that make you feel? Horrible, right? And if they became a blue diamond, how do you think that would make you feel? Really bad. So you do want to be mindful of not editing your list, constantly adding to your list, which is what I'm going to teach you today, to put people on your list. When you think of these kind of characteristic traits, think of who do you know who has a special quality? Maybe they are, you know, particularly outgoing, or they're just the type of person that's really well respected, or they're the type of person that if they do something, other people are going to follow because they're a leader, or somebody that just is at the right time and place in their life. Maybe they have a special need. Maybe you know that they've been negatively impacted by the bad economy, or you know that they're at a transition point. Like I said, when I got back to work, I found that a lot of my friends were also looking to re-engage in the workforce, but they weren't necessarily at the right, you know, ability to kind of jump back into their previous career. This became a great option. Anyone that you know who likes to look and feel good. And that's kind of like you think of who do you know that's at the gym, that's kind of constantly on the cutting edge, kind of always put together? These are people that often can relate to our products. So you kind of create this list, and then also I always put professionals in the trade. Those are people that you know that for a living, they get paid to make you look good and feel good. They definitely can relate to it. So this is your list, you start there, but what happens when you are finished prospecting everyone on your list? Does your business end? No, that's where for me it just began, right? So I'm gonna share with you some situational prospecting. And I'm just going to kind of give you some high-level overviews before I jump into some stories. So the first thing is that if you want to be a master prospector, you have to master the art of small talk. That's why I'm so good at this, because I just like talking. How many people like talking? I don't care if it's about weather, shoes, right? I mean, it doesn't really matter to me. I enjoy people. And when you enjoy people, you can do anything with this business. How many of you like people? Just like, genuinely like people, right? It's just, then the business becomes an easy way to grow it because, oh, I'm noticing who's got translation because the hands went up after. Okay. A little bit of a delay. And apologies again to my translators. I know I'm not the most easily translatable person. So become aware of prospecting moments. And a moment is anything. A moment is there's an adorable little baby that keeps crawling up on the stage. Now, I know that the mother of that adorable little baby is obviously in our business, so she's kind of off limits. However, if I was somewhere and I saw a cute little baby doing that, I would use that as an opportunity to start a conversation with the mother. Do you know what I mean? If I noticed somebody reading a book on a train, even if I had no interest in the title of that book, I'm going to ask them, oh, how's your book? Would you recommend it? It's looking for opportunities that just present themselves where you can jump into small talk. Because if you can get into the small talk part of the prospecting, then everything else happens naturally after, and it sounds normal. If you just walk up to people, which believe me, I have done, and I built my business initially from walking up to strangers, right? And I would stand by Grand Central Station. Jessica, never do this, by the way. You know, it's like I raise my kids, don't talk to strangers, but you could talk to them if they look nice, but you don't really want to talk to strangers. It's kind of a little bit of a, it's definitely a mixed message. But I would walk up to really successful looking business people and I would stop them and say, excuse me, sir, can I ask you a crazy question? And they would stop because I was 22. And when a 20 something year old, this is why my Swedish men are going to do just fabulous, because everyone's going to stop and talk to them and my women, of course, but like, it's so much fun to see this. And I would ask them if they were open-minded to hearing about a lucrative business. And they would look at me, first I would say, are you an open-minded business person? And they would say, yeah, like kind of like, what are you talking about? And I would just jump into my power line and say, I happen to be expanding, and the way I would say it today is I happen to be expanding a new brand of a $2 billion international company in the area. And I know it's crazy and we don't even know each other, but you seem like you're such a sharp businessman. And I'd love to know, are you open to learning about a way to diversify your income? And people would often just get caught off guard and they wouldn't even know kind of what to do. So they would give me their business card. And then I would call them back the next day. I was really good about follow-up. And I would say, hi, remember me? I was that crazy woman who stopped you on the street and asked you if you were open-minded to hearing about a business. And then I would get very serious. And I'd say, and I wanted to let you know that what I said was really true. We are. And then I would kind of go into my highlights. And this is how, as was mentioned, I met my husband. So the way it really was my sister and I were at a networking event. Okay. Jessica, close your ears. It was really a bar, but I usually, you know, kind of say it was a networking event to protect my children, but she's 18, so. Okay, so it was a bar, and my sister and I went there, and And we see these two men standing by the kind of by the outside of the bar, and we walked over to them and started talking. And I was saying, "So are you open-minded businessmen?" And you know, they're like, "Yes." And my husband was like, you know, really aggressively interested in what I had to say. And then I said to him, "Do you have a business card?" You know, and that's like what we try and do, right? You need to get the card so you have control over the situation. He could not give me his business card fast enough. And of course, you know, whenever we talk about it, he says, "I'm not so sure who was prospecting who that day." So that was a good journey. But anyway, so you never really know. You have to be aware of the prospecting moments. Memorize a power line, which I'm going to share with you mine. You'll hear it kind of over and over again. This is the key, though. Okay, so I find a lot of people are good with the small talk, but where they're not sure is how do you go from "I love those shoes" to "Do you want to hear a better way to make money?" So that transition question, I'm gonna teach you what that is. Be diligent with follow-up. How many of you, admittedly, are really good at prospecting but not so good at follow-up? Okay. I'm glad to see so many of you raising your hands, because truthfully, it is the number one problem. Like, a lot of prospectors by nature kind of get the thrill, which I know I do, of meeting people and talking to people, and you kind of consider it a challenge, like, ooh, what am I going to say to get their card? But then the follow-up kind of lacks. The money is in the follow-up. Right? The money is in getting on the phone with immediate sense of urgency and calling that person while it's fresh in their mind that they met you, and doing the follow-up. So really, really important, kind of keep daily of your of all your prospects and make sure that you're going through it. And most of all, you have to have fun. If you're not having fun with this, then people know that. When I prospect, I genuinely, you know, am enjoying the situation, so it's kind of an easy thing for me to do. You just have to make sure you have fun with it. So small talk conversations, kind of obvious. You know, if something's going on in the economy or there's some like particular newsworthy event going on, it's something to talk to people about. I mean, literally to just, you know, to just bring up a conversation and just say, and it could be weather related. You know, if you're experiencing extreme hot or extreme cold, or I know you guys don't get a lot of snow here, but every time there's a snowstorm by where we are, people are anticipating it for days. That's all we talk about. Can you believe the snowstorm's coming? And, you know, are you prepared? And have you gone food shopping? Like as if, you know, like the snow is going to last forever. It's the funniest thing to me. But anyway, I love it because it's a great prospecting topic. Time. When I travel, I'll stop and I'll ask people, you know, if I don't have my watch on, you know, do you know what time it is? And then start a conversation. I'll say, can you tell me where such and such a location is? And you know, it's really funny. You can do it in your own backyard. Like, it doesn't even matter. You don't even have to be traveling to ask people for directions. I do it in the city all the time, even though I know where I'm going. But I'll say, is Fifth Avenue that way or this way? And then I'll say, I can't believe that I've been living in New York, you know, in the outskirts, but living here for so long, and I still can't remember how these streets go. The proper person's probably thinking, what an idiot, because they're kind of linear and, you know, numerical, but whatever. Books, like I said, if I'm on the train, I will walk up and down until I see someone that looks like I want to prospect them. And I will choose my seat accordingly. And if they're reading a book, I'll jump into the conversation and ask them, you know, is that a good book? Would you recommend it? And then, you know, I'll tell them all, you know, I'm going on a trip or I'm looking for a good book to read. And if I find, again, something that we have in common, it creates the opportunity for me to go into my transition question. Clothing, compliments, I mean, that's probably my biggest. I have recruited more women from fabulous looking shoes than probably anything, right? How many people love to hear when a woman, another woman or a man, says, wow, what a great pair of shoes? Who doesn't like a compliment, right? How many people use compliments to recruit? Right, it could be someone's hair, it could be their jacket. This is the funniest thing. I had, many of you know Ian Ziering from Beverly Hills 90210, and he's in our business. So I took him out one day recruiting, and we were in Starbucks, and a woman comes in, and she's kind of dressed pretty casually, but she's wearing a high heel of a pair of shoes. So really pretty. So she walks through and I said to her, wow, great pair of shoes. And she said, oh, you like them? I'm heading over to see my doctor and I kind of have a crush on him. Okay, so that was a little bit too much information, but I was like, okay, so we used it. And then I said to her, you need to have more opportunities to wear those shoes. And by the way, I happen to be expanding a business in the area, and then I just kind of launch into it. I said, you look like you have such a great personality. And again, you just kind of connect with someone. And I said, do you ever keep your eyes open for alternative ways to supplement your income? And she said, yes, I would love something. I have a young child at home, and I need to be home but making money. Okay, so I got her number. Next person walks in, same thing. Compliment them on the shoes, the whole thing, very easy. Then the third person comes in. I said to Ian, okay, it's your turn. So person walks in, gets their coffee, comes around the bend where we're standing. And it was the funniest thing because he knew he had to compliment the shoes, but he wasn't really sure how the whole thing would go. So he just looked at her and he goes, great pair of purple shoes. And then she's wearing a purple shirt. He goes, I love the way you match the shoes to the top. And by the way, I happen to be expanding this business. It was the worst transition, but it worked because, you know, it was, well, also because it was Ian. But anyway, so conversation starters that I like to ask people, now I'm in a conversation with them, maybe wherever, you're at the gym, you meet somebody new, you know, you're talking a conversation. These are just some things I'll ask people. I'll say, oh, so what do you do for a living? They say, I'm a plumber. I say, really? I hear that's a great way to make a lot of money. What do you do for a living? I'm a teacher. Really? I hear that's a great way to make a lot of money. Now, why do I do that? Because no matter what their occupation is, after I say that, they always say, really? Not from what I know. And then I say, interesting. By the way, do you ever keep your eyes open for alternative ways to supplement your income? And it works every time. So I ask people, where are you from? All the time. So wherever, especially when I'm traveling in the airport, I'll go, where are you from? Oh, I'm from California. Really? I'm expanding my business to California. Where are you from? Texas. Really? I happen to be expanding my business to Texas. Where are you from? Idaho. Really? I happen to be expanding my business to Idaho. Why? Because if you just get into the business, I have just expanded my business to Idaho. So it doesn't even matter where it is. I just use that as a transition line. This happened today. Okay, so today, Jessica and I went shopping. We had to use a little shopping time, girls' time in Barcelona. So we were at a great store, and the gentleman that was helping us just had a fantastic personality. And at some point in the process, because she's trying on clothes, and he keeps bringing us new things, and I said to him, you're really great at what you do. This store must pay you a fortune to keep you here. And he goes, no, not really. I said, well, then you're underpaid because if you were in my business, you'd make a fortune. And then he goes, what do you think he asked me? What's your business? And I said, I happen to be in an amazing company. We get paid for helping people look younger, feel younger, and make a lot of money. And I said, you open to hearing about a great way to diversify your income? He said, absolutely. So he gave me his business card, which I gave to Sam. Where is Sam? Sam, there you are. You need to follow up. Let me know how that goes. I'm hoping I just found you a blue diamond. So, do you believe in fate? Oh my God, this is my favorite line ever. So, whenever I meet people and it's in a slightly unusual circumstance, I always say to them, do you believe in fate? I would like to believe it's fate that you and I just met. And I happen to be expanding my business in the area and I'm looking for people. I will use this line like if I'm in a taxi and I'm getting out of the taxi and the person who's getting into the taxi looks like a really good person, I'll say to them, oh my gosh, do you believe in fate? And they look at me like I'm crazy and I'll say, with all the taxi cabs that you could be getting out of and I could be getting into, I would like to believe it's fate that we have just met this way. And I happen to be expanding a business in the area and I'm looking for people. And then I'll say, do you have a business card? I know we don't have time, but I would love to connect with you. That has been working like a charm. I'll tell you the other time, how many women in this room have been pregnant while in this business? Okay, I have a message for everyone. You're going to have to go out and get pregnant, because prospecting pregnant, I'm telling you, when you are pregnant, it is the best time to prospect, because do you know why? Everyone is attracted to a pregnant woman, and everyone wants to touch the stomach of a pregnant woman. Even if they don't know you, they want to touch you. So when I was pregnant, I started noticing, like, people would be the weirdest thing. They would come up to me, they put their hands on my stomach, they'd be like, oh, and then it's like you could see them reminiscing about their pregnancies, you know, and as they're like touching your stomach. So what do you think I would do? I would say, you know, I gotta just mention something. I would like to believe it's fate that your hand is on my stomach and I don't even really know you. And I happen to be expanding a business and I'm looking for people who, but like, so some of you, if your prospecting is not going so well, you know what to do. Okay, so your transition questions. Again, I'll be having a great conversation with someone, and then out of nowhere, I'll just say, can I ask you a crazy question? It's because I want them to know that I know that what I'm doing is slightly crazy. And I'll say, or I'll say, can I just ask you a totally non-related question? And then that's when I jump into my line. So the optional add-on is, do you consider yourself to be an open-minded business person? Or at some point within my conversation, I always, when it's in this situation, I will use a compliment. I'll say, you have such a great personality, or you've got such great energy, or you seem to be, you seem like you have such great people skills, like the guy that I met today. And then I go into my power line. And I happen to be expanding a new genetic-based anti-aging company, brands of a $2 billion company in the area, and I'm looking for people to help in the expansion. So here's my crazy question. And then again, it could be any of these. Do you ever keep your eyes open for alternative ways of making money outside of what you currently do? Would you be open to learning or exploring, I like to use the word exploring, about a way to diversify your income or create a residual income if it didn't jeopardize what you're currently doing? I find that for a lot of people, if they get concerned that I'm already, you know, an attorney or I'm already a business executive, I want them to understand that this is a way to diversify and supplement their income, but it doesn't have to take away or replace what they're currently doing. It's kind of an important part of it. And then the goal is to get their business card. And also, I just want to mention that with all of this prospecting, it's honestly not what you say. You do have to be prepared with things to say, but it's really much more about the delivery. It's more about them liking you, about you developing a rapport with a little bit of a relationship with them. And prospecting is everywhere. It's everywhere. I mean, it's all around us. Like, I just have up here some of my favorite places to prospect. Trains, gyms. You know, I've often said to people that feel like their warm market has run out to change the gyms that they work out. Like, don't just constantly go back to the same place. Take exercise classes, spinning classes, whatever it is, in different locations so that you can expand the audience, the amount of people. Like I said, trains, I don't just sit on a train. When I go on an airplane, my husband finds this very annoying, but I usually get us separate seats so that we don't sit together, because then it doubles up my prospecting. And then at some point after we've met the people, then we kind of, you know, say, you know, can we switch seats? But only after we've done the meeting. He finds that annoying. I mean, come on, really? So, by the way, how many people in this room are the prospector, but then your spouse finds it a little annoying? Okay, oh, not many, that's good. I have to tell you some stories about that. Vacation, this is really funny, but on the last Team Elite trip that we had, which was in Paris, we did a fun journey day with Scott Schwartz and Julia, and also the Salters. And so the six of us went around and we were visiting Notre Dame and Sacré-Cœur, and we were like kind of walking around and visiting all these fabulous sites. So every place we would go, we would stop and take a picture. So what I've discovered was that taking a picture was a great place to prospect people. So what would happen is, we were at the Louvre, and you could see a woman taking a picture of her husband, and then they'd quickly change, and then he'd take a picture of her. So I would walk up to them and say, I have a great idea. How about if I take a picture of the two of you, and then when you're done, you could take a picture of me and my husband? And they'd say, great. So we would do the picture exchange. So now I'm kind of building a relationship with them. I've really helped them out. They're helping me out. And then I would stop and I'd say, where are you from? We're from New York. We're from California. We're from Germany. We're from, because, you know, when you're traveling, especially in places like this, it's from people all over. Of course, what do I say? Really? I happen to be expanding my business there. I know this is totally crazy and we've just met, but I'd like to believe it's fate that we happen to wind up, of all places, in front of the Louvre together at the same time. And I'm looking for people. So I've combined a few of my power lines there. I'm looking for people to expand my business. Do you ever keep your eyes open for alternative ways to diversify your income? I'm telling you, every single place we went, Matt Salter was videotaping me, by it's probably on YouTube at some point. He was cracking up at how much that worked. I mean, so then I was taking the train into Grand Central, where I do meetings every week. By the way, anyone has meeting prospects in New York, you are welcome to send them. OTG, we need to rock this world. So New York, keep it in mind. But anyway, I was with a group of my distributors, and they know about all my stories. And I said to them, but you can do it in Grand Central. I said, everyone takes pictures in Grand Central Station. So we started walking over to people that were taking pictures and say, oh, do you want us to take a picture of you? And then, where are you from? And they told us. I'm like, oh my gosh, we're expanding our business there. But we were doing it in our own backyard. So it was great. It just absolutely worked. Anytime you are on airplanes, like, I always laugh. How many of you flew here? Just by a show of hands. Okay, so when you fly home, you know you have a job to do, right? You have to, one, separate from whoever you're traveling with. Two, you have to engage in a conversation. But the key is the small talk. I don't sit on a plane and then immediately go, oh my God, I'm expanding my business in the area and I'm looking for people. I don't do that. I talk to them. So were you traveling on business, pleasure, where are you from, what do you do for a living? I make it very natural. It is really on airplanes when I have time, just totally low key. And then it's at the last moments that I'll say, you know, it was so fantastic to get to know you. And I know this is going to sound crazy, but you have such a great personality. And I'm looking for people just like you to expand my business. Do you ever keep your eyes open? I do it with this face, like as if I've just thought of this for the very first time. And I go, do you ever keep your eyes open for alternative ways to diversify your income? Right? Like, it's so natural. Like, I just thought of this. And of course they say, you know, yes or no, whatever. And I get their business card. But it's fun things like that that really make your business. I had, this just happened. We were in Vail, Colorado a couple of months ago, and we were taking off our boots, and there's a woman there, and she had a little girl, and she had these adorable patent leather little boots. She was 5 years old, and I just looked at the mother, and I said, oh my gosh, if they had those boots in my size, I would totally want those shoes. Again, it's all about the shoes. So she says, I know. She goes, she actually said, ah, Dios mío, yo sé. And she said she was from Mexico. So, but she just launched into Spanish. And then she says, I said to her, where are you from? And she says, Mexico. And now, you have to understand what's going on at this moment is it's chaotic. Everyone's taking their boots off, put their shoes on. And it got really crazy. And I figured we're staying in the same place. I'll see her again tomorrow. So I walk out. And then I said to myself, oh my God, what did I just do? I just gave up a prospecting moment. I can't believe I did that. And Mitchell, my husband, says to me, don't worry about it. You'll see her tomorrow. We're going to be here for a week. You'll see her every day probably. And I go, okay. And then I go, no, not okay. What if she's leaving? What if today was her last day? It might be our first day, but it could be her last day. I can't do it. I got to go back. So I walk back. And now I look like an idiot, like, why did I walk back? And she just kind of looked at me, and I just said, oh, I think I lost my key. You know, it was like the first thing that came to my mind. So I'm now looking on the floor for my fake key that I didn't really lose. And now she has her daughter helping me find my key, which was, then I'm feeling guilty, you know, that this adorable little 5-year-old is like part of my scam. But anyway, so We finally, and I go, oh, you know what? Oh, it's in my jacket pocket. So silly. So then I said, by the way, where in Mexico City are you from? And she tells me, and the funny part is, when we were little, in high school, my parents took us to Acapulco, and I met this family that was from Bosques de las Lomas, which was the area that she lived in Mexico City. And I said, oh my God, that is so bizarre. I said, I'm expanding my business to Mexico, and I happen to like know someone that lives there. Anyway, she said, what's your business? And I said, it's Nu Skin. Have you ever heard of it? She said, ah, Dios mío, it's those little pearls, right? And I said, and the galvanic spa. And I said, yes. I said, you know our company? She says, yes, I love your products. And and she says, I've been using your product, and the person that sold it to me, I can't find them anymore. And I said, really? Interesting. And I mean, what are the odds? And I said, and then by the way, she did leave the next day, and I never saw her again after that. So I was like, thank goodness I got her number. So guys, prospecting is all around you. You really just have to, you have to do a few things. You have to be oriented for it. You have to really set your goals. You do need a power prospecting line so that you're comfortable with it wherever you are. And you do need to keep it on the brain. You have to really be committed to the prospecting, because then it's the opportunity that the business never ends. It never, ever, ever slows down. I'm going to end with one story because I just think it kind of encompasses what I do and who I am. So I asked how many of you have you ever like had a night where your spouse said to you, honey, no prospecting tonight? Anyone? You guys obviously chose really well, because my husband, from time to time, Jessica, don't tell daddy I'm saying this, will say to me, honey, you know, could you shut it off just for today? And then I remind him that that's how we met, and if it wasn't who I was, we would not have known each other. So I remind him about that. But in any case, this one night we were going out. It was New Year's Eve. It's a very special night. It was a night just the two of us. And we were having, he had a very romantic evening plan. And he gives me the, honey, not tonight, okay? We're on the same page? Yes, honey, we're on the same page. So we go to the restaurant. And of course, it's New Year's Eve, so they're trying to maximize their income potential for the night. And the tables seem to be very close, and a lot of people. And it's New Year's Eve, so everyone is looking their best. Okay, so already I walk into the room and I'm like, oh my God, I'm looking. Everyone's looking. It's like a drug. Everyone's looking so good. So I sit down. And I'm looking around, and I'm thinking about what my husband said to me, and I'm focusing on him. So I'm just like, so at some point, I'm looking around, and a woman sitting next to me who's really attractive looking drops her pocketbook. No, my pocketbook drops. And this woman sitting next to me taps me on the shoulder, and she says, excuse me, your pocketbook just fell. And I said, thank you. Oh my God, I'm having a prospecting moment. So I said, thank you. And then she says, and your dress is so pretty. She like compliments me. And I said, oh, I couldn't help but notice you look so lovely too. And then I'm having the conversation in my head, should I, shouldn't I, should I, shouldn't I? And, you know, I'm looking at him. And then I just very quietly turn around to her and I said, I know this isn't really the time and place for it, but I happen to be expanding a business in the area, and you look like such a great person. And later on, just give me your name and number. I want to contact you about something really exciting. And then I turn around, kind of hoping he didn't notice, and he looks at me and he goes, do you feel better now? I said, yes, I do. So that to me is prospecting. And it's not when you get into Nu Skin, it's when Nu Skin gets into you. I hope that helps. Have a great day.